Sir, Ms. Pauline Mangilog Saltarin. She is the creative director of JESCOM, head writer also of Cine Escuela and Bantay Kalikasan TV. She produced Five and Up and was part of the Pro Team. She was a producer, director, and trained producers at the MESAT Broadcast Network, Kuala Lumpur. She is a scholar with an AB Communications degree from Ateneo de Manila. And Pauline co-produced Ignacio with Ernestine Tamana. Ernest Tamana, co-producer of Ignacio de Loyola. Worked with Pauline on more than 50 projects from documentaries, talk shows, music videos, AVPs, and public service ads. Won awards in the Philippines and abroad, including the Telly Awards, the International Festival of Audiovisual de Barcelona, Japan Prize, Catholic Mass Media Awards, and most recently, Poland's 29 International Catholic Film and Multimedia Festival. Our lead actor, Andreas Munoz. Born in Madrid. By the way, just a bit of trivia for you guys. He missed the first casting call in Madrid. Then he flew to Barcelona for the second casting call. His first film, The Devil's Backbone, was directed by Guillermo del Toro. First leading role was in Arena en los Bolsillos, and he also was the best actor at the 2008 Notcorts Film Festival. Did I say that correctly?
Yes.
Notcorts Film Fest. Notecortes.
Yes.
Yes, there you go. Notecortes Film Fest for the short film Paredes. Main character in Casi Angeles, Larissa. Okay. And he owes to the Disney Channel games in the US. Something similar, okay? Disney. Finding the connection. Okay, he also performs with a band as a drummer and singer, and he studied drama at the Royal School of Dramatic Art. Okay, now, our director, Paolo D. Woohoo! This is his first feature film. This is his directorial debut, okay? He graduated high school and college at the Ateneo de Manila. Yes! Ad Mayorem Dei Gloriam. Directed over 100 TVCs, which aired across the Asia Pacific. He is the co-creator, by the way, of Vanji. If that went viral, that's about the Pinoy virtual assistant. He's also a consistent Anvil awardee and Gold Quill awardee. He is a finalist at the New York Festivals. First place on MTV Asia's The Pitch screenwriting competition in Singapore for his screenplay, The Oracle. He also won first place in the US National 24-Hour Film Racing Competition 2010 with his film Creative License. And first place in the Bogan Imaging Short Film Competition New York for Miko. Wait, it's okay? Another heavyweight is the cinematographer Shots Shabahaladon. She took care of that one. And also we'd like to acknowledge from the Central Digital Labs, editor Cheryl Lopez. And colorist Richard Francia. And because as I was saying earlier, this really feels like a very happy reunion. And you know what? It's very special. It's made extra special because we have friends who even flew in from Madrid, Spain. We'd like to welcome the Munoz family, Luis, Lola, and Gara. They flew all the way from Madrid to support Andreas. Okay, woohoo! But you know, much of the credit of this amazing project goes to the executive director of JESCOM Philippines. Here to represent Father Emmanuel Nono Alfonso is the marketing manager of JESCOM, Ms. Dit Sablan. And she has something to share to all of you today.
I have been tasked to read his message, so at the name script. I have been asked three important questions concerning this ambitious film project. First, is it really necessary, or is there really a need for it? Or is JESCOM just bored, or worse, just being whimsical? Did we just wake up one morning and said, enough of our TV shows, let's aim for the stars. Let's do something that would make us famous or popular. Saint Ignatius tells us that the Jesuit goes where there is a greater need. That applies to this project and every project that JESCOM does. For the past many years, our schools have been bugging us about new materials on the life of our founder, Ignatius of Loyola. Apparently, what is being shown in freshman orientation days is a 1949 black and white Spanish but dubbed in English film. How sad and ironic, especially in this so-called digital age. And during the time of the first Jesuit Pope, Pope Francis, there are existing docudramas on the life of Ignatius from the US, but these are not feature films. Being talkies, they do not seem to appeal to the young. It is therefore very clear to us, friends, why we are doing this film. The inspiring story of Ignatius must be retold again to our time and especially for our youth. Next page. Script. Second, why this medium? Why a film? What can it do? What impact can it have? To this set of questions, I say, thank God for General Luna. Talk of impact of a film, not only has the film earned more than 240 million pesos, but it has revived interest in history, not just in schools, but more importantly, the general public. Even today, after almost a month of its release, radio and TV shows are still talking about the film and letting it mirror the sad plight of our country. Bayan o sarili. General Luna's quote in the movie has now been tweeted, quoted 1,000 times. On a personal note, I became a Jesuit because of many inspirations. Admittedly, unabashedly, I was inspired by two movies involving Jesuits, The Mission and Romero. I am sure you can also relate to that. I am sure movies have inspired your life. That is why there are classics like the Ten Commandments, Jesus of Nazareth, or, on a secular note, Star Wars, E.T., etc. Movies have that power upon us. Stories inspire us. Visuals and visions change us. We learned that from Jesus himself, the greatest of communicators, the very word of God. He simply told us parables and stories and shared with us the wonderful vision of the kingdom of God. And yet, a faith, a church, a holy people that followed him because of that. People say we would rather give to construction of buildings because they tend to last. But movies, stories, ideas endure forever. Finally, can you do it? 50 million pesos is not a joke. The most expensive project we have ever done was with Marilu Diaz Abaya, a telemovie entitled Maging Aking Muli, which cost us 5 million pesos. But 50 million pesos, wow, what a leap. But naively, perhaps, I have faith in God's people. First, there is our production people, actors, writers, directors. They have agreed to work on a very tight budget. God bless them all for their generosity. Secondly, there are the initial donors and benefactors who believed in our cause, who believe that we need to have quality films, religious films to educate the public and inspire the world. Hopefully, after today, there can be more. Finally, there is God. This is really a leap of faith for us. But since we started, despite the bumps on the road, we can feel God's hand guiding us. We have many stories about God's providence. Too many to share now, but I do believe that that hand has brought you to us. Please help us. Please join us. Please join Ignacio. Maraming salamat po. Father Nono Alfonso, S.J.
Including the Father General of the Jesuits over there. We wanted to show them like a work in progress type of screening and to get started, like we wanted to get their blessing in many ways, right? That, the film's content was something that they would agree with, they would be enthusiastic about, and that we weren't like straying too far away from who Ignatius really was. And that's the feedback that they gave us, that they were very happy that the movie accurately represents who Ignatius was, his philosophy, what made him special. So we're very happy about that.
And this is again the first Filipino film to be ever screened at the Vatican. Now that is really amazing. Makes us all so proud to be Filipino. So even with that, that's already such a success with that alone. Okay. Oh, by the way,
we do have the support of the Jesuit community, and by implication, I suppose that includes. I think it's kind of like the other way around. The Pope has made such a wonderful impact on, I think, the church and the world in general. And this film, in many ways, is an attempt to support that message of openness and, you know, mercy, and trying to go to the peripheries and trying to go where the church sometimes fears to go. So it's a little bit like that. We're the ones being fanboys of St. Pope Francis and helping him spread that message.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that question. Now, do we have a
screening? So Father Nono attended that screening. Present were some members of the board. And I will not say who, but there's a very prominent director, writer, who viewed the film, and she said, goosebumps, yes. The same reaction as you. And she said she's not Catholic, but she found the film to be very well made and very, you know, she thought about her faith also after, so that's good. And after the screening, we were given a rated PG rating, so which means as long as you have, you can bring your child with you. It's for children of all ages, as long as you're with them, you're the parent or teacher. So yeah, that's it's good news for us, because you know that all the Ateneos, we have a grade school as well. So yeah, as long as the teachers are with the kids, then they can watch.
We will fight. Diba? Sabi dun sa trailer, one big fight at the area represent, diba? What did Cardinal Tagle give also his official stamp of approval and the Catholic Church here in the Philippines?
Yeah, in fact, even before, when we were still trying to raise some funds for the film, he gave a video endorsement. So he made a plea if, you know, people can contribute. But it didn't stop there. He even he's written a letter, and then along with the other bishops, like the Bishop of Pasig and Parañaque, I believe, they're endorsing the film to the parishes and the Catholic community. And of course, CEAP, which is the Catholic Education Association of the Philippines. So all the Catholic schools, the film is highly recommended by CEAP.
Okay, that's wonderful. That we have this much support, and of course the love from the Catholic community in the Philippines for the film is already there, right? And of course, we look forward to more support from our friends from the media, because as you can see, this film really is quality.
Having their casting there, because they were gonna shoot 2 weeks after us. So some of the creative team passed by, looked at the locations. I think it was the scenes for the Dothraki scenes of Dorne and in the season 6.
Okay, wow, amazing trivia. Okay, you know, that's wonderful.
And we saw on one side they were talking about Game of Thrones, and on the other side they're talking about, oh, Ignacio de Loyola is shooting here over here. So we're like, that was a thrill.
Wow, that's truly thrilling talaga. What do you have it? Do you have the newspaper or the public?
History of Ignatius and the history of the society, especially from the Jesuits themselves, who also looked over the script and gave their own stamp of approval on everything that we were planning. As far as putting the character of Ignatius together in the film, I'll give you to Andreas.
Hello. Once I received the script, obviously I asked Paolo the different layers of the character and what he wanted to say with that character. So we started to work back and forth all the time. Through Skype. Over Skype all the time. Because I was in London, he was here, so it could not be possible. And by myself, I was reading, well, they sent me the biography of Ignacio Loyola. I read a lot of books. I started to read Amadís de Gaula, which is Book of the Night of Amadís de Gaula, which Inigo de Loyola was reading. And after that, to prepare the Ignacio, I was reading the spiritual exercises as well. Visiting museums, paintings, reading a lot, talking to Jesuits as well, and talking with Paolo about what he wanted to say. So that was a preparation of the character.
I'd also like to ask Andreas, you missed the ticket, book a flight, so that you can get into this role and audition for the film.
Well, the first thing, I wanted to audition for that character. I didn't know anything about him. I knew he was a soldier. And I got a description of the soldier that my friend Chris Down sent it to me. So he sent me a message saying, like, Andreas, I think you are this character. So I wanted to audition for that, but I couldn't go to Madrid because I was getting ready for Hamlet in the UK. So I sent my brother, Omar, to the audition. I said to him, give my story, give my CV, please talk about me, because I really want that character. And obviously, the script, I've got a monologue, a beautiful monologue with a dualism of characters. And that got me. That was the thing that got me. The way it was written, it was fantastic. And after they met my brother, they called me to go to, they said, we're gonna come back to Barcelona, would you like to audition for it? And I said, of course, yes.
Wow, yes. So Omar, you are the key.
Yes.
You are really good at selling Andreas, no?
I will point out two more things in addition to that. Omar, of course, is himself an actor. In fact, he was in The Way with Martin Sheen. Right, he was and Emilio Estevez. He was the boy who stole something of the ashes of the, yeah, so he's the one who stole this. That's Omar over there, so if you wanna review that film. So the first thing I'll say is that when Omar came over to the audition, I learned this later on, Andreas was like, Omar, you give my showreel, but don't steal my role. Fortunately, the real Ignatius was not as tall as Omar, so he was. The second thing I'll point out is that is that when Andreas came over to Barcelona and did the final reading for us, finally, we had sent him some sides already, some part of the script already, and he came in and he, you know what, first take, nailed it completely. So from there, it was already decided that he was going to be Ignatius. So fantastic.
Wonderful.
May I just add?
Yes.
We're we're airing, broadcasting the behind the scenes documentary on our Facebook page. So tonight, tomorrow, Pauline, tomorrow in at what time?
8 p.m.
We'll be broadcasting the casting. So in that webisode, you will see Andreas's audition and Omar as a little boy auditioning. So please.
There's one more thing, there's an anecdote here, and that I wanted the part so much that for the first time in my life, I lost my plane from London to Barcelona. Oh. I lost it, and I haven't got more money. It was like 300 quid to go to Barcelona. And I talked to my family and I said, like, what am I gonna do? And they bought me the ticket to go there. They said, like, don't worry, we'll buy the ticket. So, yeah.
Yes, and now they're here in Manila.
Yes, of course.
All out support. Woohoo. You know, that's wonderful that you have this much sibling love instead of like sibling rivalry. Because, you know, Omar could have auditioned for the part and like just.
You never know.
That's true, though. So thank you for sharing that amazing story, and we can't wait to catch the behind the scenes footage.
Film was going to premiere in the Vatican.
Oh, I was flabbergasted. Mm-hmm. Who gets to do that, right? At the same time, it felt very natural to take that step because, yeah, you do want to have the people who, I guess, the descendants of Ignatius to like see the story that we made about that thing. So yeah, I think the whole team was very thrilled. If I had the power to do that, I would bring all of us there and have us there. But as it turned out, it was a very intimate screening, and so I guess it was. I'll tell you that it was another goosebump moment for us to be there, and knowing that Pope John Paul II used to watch films there. And you know, Pope Benedict also was. It was a very special moment. So yeah, that's something I will always remember.
We have a question to create that look for the film, and what made you decide that this is how it should look like.
Have to pardon my voice.
Okay.
Essentially, it's the vision of Direct Paolo, and of course. When I saw the location photos, they've been there twice, I think, and they showed me the different locations where they plan to shoot. When I saw it, I'll be honest, Game of Thrones didn't come into my mind, but instead, you know, I was so curious about the life of Ignacio and how he was when he was growing up, his family, you know, how they are. And Spain is so beautiful. When you get there, it's one of, you know, lighting it is very simple, I have to admit. I have used less lights for it, although we were very particular in the lenses that we use and in the camera that we use. But I think it's God-given, you know, Spain, the actual location where he was born, the places that, the museums, the weather was also perfect. So it was a big help. It's a very natural, organic film, which I'm very, very proud of because that alone is an inspiration.
Thank you very much. Did you bring anything?
We were very fortunate to be able to use one of the latest anamorphic lenses ever produced in the world. Like we had like the set number 3,
yes.
Because our local. There are only 11 in the whole world of that lens. It's called the Cook Anamorphic 2i series, right? And we had set number 3 in the whole world. And so we brought our cameras and lenses from here. When we got there, the local crew over there opened the boxes and like, oh my goodness, why do you have this lens? We don't have this lens yet. You know? So we're very happy to have had that. It contributed a lot to the look of it. Right. So,
wow.
Yeah. I'll also say that directly, by the end of the shoot, the entire Spanish lighting crew was like that figure. Because they were so amazed at how wonderfully she was able to achieve that image with maybe half or a third of the lights that normally they would use there in Spain. So they were just, they were saying, my master, my genius there. So that's how they were calling her then by the end of the show.
Bravo, Miss Lee. Wow, amazing.
The the art department, you know, I'd like to say that the art department is very key, you know, we direct vision again. I think it's a totally different story, but we made it through, you know, with the money that we have, with the time that we have to prepare, makeup, costume, and everything. Bringing the props there is no joke. You know, that's one of the wonderful things that happened to us, is that it created a certain bond, a journey for everybody. And it's, you know, it's just preparing for the shoot. So you can imagine from preparation to the shoot, going back, post-production, and now after a year, I was just telling Miss Pauline here that, you know, I was crying looking at one of the posts and one of the indies, you know, one of the staff who worked in the project. So for the art department, I think Direct Paul can share some more of what happened there.
So prior to the shoot, during pre-prod, we already knew that it was going to be very expensive to create, to build there in Spain. So there was an idea to build everything here, make everything, even the costumes. So eventually we were able to make 400 plus costumes, sets, and 5 tons worth of sets and props. Yeah, so can you imagine the volume and, you know, the work that went through putting everything together? And I think Kang can talk about the shipping the everything to Spain and back.
And back. That's important.
Yeah, that was actually when we, I work as a, one of the, Derby was joking, one of the indies. So my main task really was production, was shipping of the materials, the 5 tons worth of materials. Initially here in the Philippines, we actually thought we could leave some of the stuff because we have props for war scene. And ideally, we were thinking we can destroy these things. So on the way back, it shouldn't be a problem. On the way there, it was a bit easy because we were in the Philippines. So, you know, but of course, having to adjust with the systems. At that time, we also had problems in terms of containers being stuck in the port. So in the political side of it. But anyway, but that was, I think, hard, but it was more challenging thinking about bringing it back, because in the Spanish law required that we were allowed to bring it in for the shoot. We explained that this is where we were going to use it, etc., etc., but the promise was we were given a lower charge for tax and all. The promise was we were to bring it back to the Philippines, so we brought them all back as well. Yes. But we're really thankful also to the people who helped us there in Spain. I mean, even the people in the customs, they were very, very helpful. Although we had to explain that it was a religious movie, we're not Hollywood, etc. But, so they were also very helpful in that sense. They're bombs.
Some things we had to have, Gary. Kung pwede lang namin isuot yung ibang costume para makabawa sa timbang, gagawin namin. So some of us, the production designers, brought the Sword of Loyola and carried it. Because baka ma-delay yung shipping, and we were shooting right away. So we needed some props and costumes that needed to be brought there with us. So we actually got to experience how it feels to be detained by the real Guang Jasibil. Because we were holding on to the Sword of Loyola, and we landed in Bilbao, and of course they saw in the X-ray what we were carrying inside. So we had to explain what the Sword of Loyola is doing inside our stuff, and Leo had to assemble it in front of the Guang Jasibil, so we couldn't leave the airport right away. So a lot of those exciting things we had to go through.
Wow, adventure, di ba? What was the sword made of? So, since steel talaga yon? Wow.
We had it custom made by a local
Valerian steel.
It's very unique. It's one of a kind. It was specifically designed for Indigo here. So you won't see anything like it anywhere. Let me just add, though, you were asking a question kanina about the costumes. And why, and Paolo was saying production design, and directly was also saying production design is really key in this film, no? Talaga importante siya. I think Kathy can talk about the costumes and bakit, why was it so important, especially for the actors in Spain.
Okay, hello everyone. yung costumes po ay talagang grabe. Yung aming production production designer and then our members of the makeup team and for the hair department lahat. Parang I feel each person siguro did the work of 100 people. Really. I think everybody did that and probably, you know, 200, 300 people maybe. Pao maybe for 500 people. He did the work of 500 people. Tulong-tulungan po talaga magtala ng mga gamit doon. And then when we got there, we sorted everything and then nag-plot na kami din ng mga costumes. So per character, we had to have something that evoke anong klaseng tao siya. So for instance, yung mga the men of Loyola, the brother of Inigo, his father, you'll usually see them clothed in the colors of the house. So you've got the reds and the golds. And then there's also other Magdalena, who is Inigo's sister-in-law, who introduced him actually to the book, The Life of Christ and the Lives of the Saints. The books that he read, that kind of triggered the moment of the spiritual journey in his life. She's usually dressed in the browns and grays, a little bit more austere. All of that, sinort siya, and this was, I think it was a bit, almost a ton of costumes. And we had to weigh each one, we had to weigh each costume, ship them, sort them when we got there. So I have to really, give my praise to the production design team and the wardrobe team and hair and makeup. And everybody here actually, because even our producers were also helping out and sewing costumes and grabe, lahat po kami nagtatahe para lang talagang kasya yung costume na maganda tsaka sigurado tayong quality yung lalabas.
Grabe, it's amazing to hear
these. Not the bad words. Are you sure? Yeah, the only ones I know.
No bad words, you're Ignacio.
It was my first experience to work with a Filipino crew and with a Filipino director. It was wonderful, to be honest. It was wonderful. We have to adapt themselves, you know, because they came to Spain. There were some regulations in Spain that are different to the Philippines, so they have to adapt. We have to adapt ourselves a bit to the lunchtime as well, the lunch break, because it's like 12:01-ish. For us, it's like 2:03. So, you know, but you get on really good. And it was amazing the way they worked, the way that everyone did a hard work. A Spanish crew, Filipino crew, everyone was like hand in hand, working hard. So it's been wonderful, to be honest.
And also you could feel the, from both parts, the passion. And when you make something with passion,
yeah,
it's wonderful to see the result and everything.
Yeah.
And I think like wonderful people that we've worked.
Yeah.
It was the first time. And I hope it's not the last one.
Yeah.
I'm surely.
What is better than union?
No. Yes. Aww. So now, in relation to that, you spoke about anything for this film or wow, direct Paolo. So we'd love to hear what did you give up for
that
this
film? That comes out very, very personal for a lot of us, because I think that we all, each one of us, we came onto this project and did. I think none of us, even us, none of us realized what a big task it would really turn out to be. And so whatever we signed on to do, I think in the end we ended up doing 2, 3, 4 times the amount of work, I think. That not because, you know, a lot of that is because we wanted to get it right. we didn't want to be there, and we're already in Spain and we're shooting this thing, and we're like, are we just gonna let it be just another movie? No, it was never about a paycheck. It was never about being able to go to Spain on someone else's dime. It was really because we wanted it to be good. And so the philosophy all throughout was like this. We were gonna put all our resources up on screen, put the money on the screen. We didn't really, when people hear about, oh, you shop in Spain, you know, you get images of tapas and wine. No, all right, everything was for the movie. Everything was get it as good as it can be, because we're doing it for the audience. We want them to enjoy the film and appreciate the film. So perhaps we'll go back someday and have the tapas and wine, but on this trip, that wasn't a priority, not in the least. So yeah, that's why I have to commend everyone. I mean, look, these soldiers of ours had given everything, that some of them have literally bled for this film. And I think we would really love it for you guys to come and come to the theater and see the fruits of our labor, and hopefully you see the value in what all these people have been able to achieve.
Okay, thank you very much. And yes, Miss
Jesscom. What did Jesscom give up? Jesscom gave up a lot. Actually, sasabihin ni Father Nonoy, he always says this, baon na siya sa utang. Because, you know, initially nga, we were saying it was just a small idea. We got inspired by the Dominicans because they produced this film, Dominique. And we said, you know, we can do something like this for St. Ignatius. We never realized that it was going to be this, as they say, epic. It's not that we're not grateful. We love the idea, but marami talagang nag-give up because of this. But for most of us, really time with family, you know, time for self. But in the end, it's all worth it, because you will see the hard work. You will see it on screen. There, everything that you see from shooting, from lighting, the performances, the editing, the coloring, we did our best and more. And this reflects the philosophy of Matches. And you know this, doing something better, something more for God.
Any more questions for our team? Yes, over here.
Are there plans for an international screening for the movie, since it's in English?
So yeah, that's actually part of the plan. That's part of the reason why we wanted it to be in English, so that we can probably reach a good wider audience, right? So yes, there are international screenings in planning, and I think eventually we'll make those announcements when they solidify.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, for Andreas, is this your first time to work with your brother in a project?
No, luckily we've been working quite in a few films. We started, that's a good thing. When I was, how old were we? Like 12, and he was younger than me, obviously he's younger than me, seven year old. So I went for a role, and he stole me that role. So the director, the first movie that we got together, my sister was in it as well, she's an actress as well. The director loved me, but then saw my brother, and she loved my brother as well. So she said, okay, Andreas, I'm gonna do one thing. I'm gonna give the role to your brother, but I'm gonna write one for you. So we are together in that film, and I think it's better because I'm bullying him in the film. So, you know, you never get to bully your brother, you know, in a film sometimes. So we've been working in that one, and then after all, we've been working in Italy as well. We've been doing Brothers in one in Terrazzo, the 24 Volte in Rome. We've been filming in Rome as well as Brothers. He's disabled. He has ELA, E-L-A. So he's amazing, that film. And well, that one. So we have natural chemistry, you know? And with my sister as well. My brother has worked with my sister.
So your entire family is into acting?
Yeah.
What's your favorite scene in the movie and why?
In the movie, I have a couple of them. I was really looking forward to do the battle scene because I think it's something that you want to do even as a child, you know, you just want to fight and with the swords, and so I was really looking forward to that. That's one of my favorite scenes, but it was hard to do because the heat, it was so high. It was 42 degrees, something like that, in Artajona. Imagine with this, all the costume and then the armor, and surrounded by fire, blood. So it was hard, but I enjoyed it a lot. And then there is another scene that you will see on the film once you watch it. It was it's in a cave. It's a cave scene, and that was completely the other way. That was really cold scene, and that was hard to do as well. But it's one of my favorites as well. Yeah.
Can you tell us a little bit about the pretty lady in the trailer? I'm sorry.
The co-actress.
Oh,
what do you want to know about that? What kind of person is that?
She's not here.
Yeah,
so.
She is lovely, she's beautiful, and she's a really good actress. She's amazing.
My last question is, if there's any lesson you've learned as a person from playing the role of St. Ignatius, what's your biggest takeaway from doing this project?
My biggest lesson. Yeah. I've got a lot, to be honest, but probably one of them is silence and patience. That's what I learned the most with this character. Silence and patience.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for that, for those questions. And do we have more from our friends?
It's my third time I've been here, and it's been lovely, to be honest. I've been eating a lot of food, a lot of Filipino food. My favorite one, believe it or not, is sisig, of course sisig. Lechon as well. I'm going to go to Cebu. I'm going to try the real lechon from Cebu. Pancit, and well, to be honest with you, all you guys, the Filipino guys, are amazing. You always have a smile in your face. And that's really welcoming, and that's something to be grateful. So I love the Philippines, and I know it's more fun in the Philippines, it's true.
Thank you for that.
So I'll just remind everyone that we have a screening on July 23rd, this Saturday. So it's going to be special one because there's a live orchestra musical scoring. So it's the first, I think it's the first time in the Philippines that it's going to be done. As in, the whole movie will be scored live. And then our premiere is on the 24th on Sunday. And the movie opens in theaters on the 27th.
27th.
Yes.
All theaters, plus selected theaters.
Selected theaters. Please watch out for the announcement for the list of theaters on our FB page. For now, it's SM and for sure Gateway and Robinson Theaters. Yeah, and Filmfest. Yeah. So Paolo will give us a. We'll wrap the press con. He prepared something for us. Yeah.
Okay.
I'll just read out something that I'd like to share with you guys. I'm really very happy to see all of you here because sometimes this in the making of this film we've realized that it's not easy to talk about in a quick, like shortcut manner. Because it doesn't fit well into easily understood genres, romance, comedy, horror, all these things. No? It's not strictly an action film, it's not strictly a historical film, it's definitely not what you'd call like a typical religious film either. Is it a saint film? The team likes to say it's more of a sinner film. No? It's very human. It's a very emotional take on the struggle of a man who had tremendous dreams, but was forced to abandon them and find another way to happiness. It's about his mistaken notions, his stumbles, his awkward attempts to transform himself, to break away from the pain of his troubled childhood and the violence of his past. So it was a struggle that nearly destroyed him. But in overcoming it, he discovered an idea, a revelation that has become the bedrock of the Jesuit order that he founded. And it continues to transform the lives of people to this day. So that's part of why we want to invite you to see this film, is to precisely experience that kind of revelation that he had. In the end, Ignacio is everything wrong and everything right about each one of us. The vanity, the envy, you know, lecherousness and violence, the anger and the pride and the disdain, but also the hope, also the capacity to change, the imagination to dream about things beyond what most people dare, the wisdom and humility to understand, even sometimes with extreme reluctance, that your life is not within your control, but it's in good hands. So I'm urging you now, all of us here, to speak with as many of these remarkable people as you can. My producers, my cast and crew, my amazing, wonderful, beautiful team. In making this film, each of them has gone through incredible struggles that parallel that of Ignacio de Loyola himself. Each of them has bled, has suffered, and has had to place incredible faith in the notion that we were being led, that we would in fact reach a finish line that many times to us seemed like it was too far away to reach. They have all sacrificed so much to bring this story to you, and for that I honor them, and I will be forever grateful for the work of their hands, of their minds, and of their hearts. So once again, I thank you for gracing us with your presence today, and I hope to see you at the premiere of Ignacio de Loyola. Thank you so much. Beautiful, gorgeous score, and that's part of the reason that everyone's looking forward to the event on the 23rd, is that it's going to be performed live, and it will be Ms. Maestro Gerard Salonga who will be leading the ABS-CBN Philharmonic Orchestra and also the Ateneo Chamber Singers who will be performing the score. So that's going to be amazing. That's going to be amazing.
Thank you very much, Direct Paolo, for pointing that out. And so once again, the music of Ignacio de Loyola was created by Maestro Ryan Kiyabyab. The live orchestration will be led by Gerard Salonga along with the Ateneo Chamber Singers and the ABS-CBN Philharmonic.
Correct.